Thank you so much for coming. My name is Francis Beckwith. I'm the visiting scholar of conservative thought and policy this year at the beautiful University of Colorado Boulder. It's been a delightful year, and one of the delights of this position is being able to invite speakers to come to campus and talk about their work. I am visiting from Baylor University in Central Texas, which is a bit more warmer in comparison to the weather we've had over the past couple of days. And there I serve as professor of philosophy and church state studies. This event is sponsored by the Center for Western Civilization, Thought and Policy. It's an academic unit of the University of Colorado Boulder that houses the position that I am honored to occupy this year. The mission of the center is to promote critical reflection on the distinctive traditions and political perspectives that characterize Western civilization, as well as fostering research, debate, and dialogue about the fundamental ideals of our time. The director of the center is Professor Robert Pasnow from the philosophy department, and the associate director is Alex Holbroom, both of whom send their regrets for this evening. Bob is actually leading a graduate seminar in philosophy, so that's his primary responsibility. Our speaker this evening is Rod Dreher. Rod is a senior editor at the American Conservative and has written and edited for the New York Post, the Dallas Morning News, the National Review, the South Florida Sun Sentinel, the Washington Times, and the Baton Rouge Advocate. Rod's commentary has been published in the Wall Street Journal, Commentary, Time Magazine, The Weekly Standard, BeliefNet, and Real Simple, among other publications, and he has appeared on NPR, ABC News, CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, and the BBC. In fact, is it this weekend you'll be on Meet the Press?
Face the Nation. Next week
he'll be on Face the Nation. He lives in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, with his wife Julie and their three children. A graduate of LSU, I have to admit, though, my favorite alumnus of LSU is not Rod Dreher, but Pistol Pete Maravich, whose biography shaped my life, maybe more so than Benedict's. Rod has written four books, including these are Crunchy Cons, The Little Way of Ruthie Lemming, How Dante Can Save Your Life, and The Benedict Option, which was released only a few weeks ago and debuted at number 7 on the New York Times bestsellers list. The title of Rod's talk this evening is The Benedict Option, The Future of Religious Conservatism in Post-Christian America. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Rod Dreher.
Well, I want to thank you all for coming out tonight. How many people here are readers of my blog? Oh, good. So a lot of you aren't. So a lot of these stories will be new. So it was so great to get here to Boulder yesterday. I saw when I got to the Denver airport, it's snowing in Boulder. I said, oh, good. Coming in from South Louisiana, where it was 85 degrees for like the past 5 days, and I said, I'll get some more winter wonderland, or at least my first winter wonderland of the season, given that we didn't really have a winter in Louisiana. So I get out of kind of the bus station. Frank Beckwith offered to come pick me up. I'm like, no, I want to walk to the hotel. I was soaked by the time I got to the hotel. This wasn't the snow I had expected. And I woke up this morning, though, thinking, why do I feel so giddy? Am I just happy to be here? Well, no, it's altitude sickness. So nevertheless, it is great to be here. You just have to look out your window, and there's the mountain where I live. You look out your window, and there's the parking lot. And it's so much nicer. Well, I want to ask a couple of things of you in the audience. Well, first, before I start my remarks, you might not agree with me at all about the nature of the crisis that we're in, or maybe even not that there's a crisis of any kind, especially if you're not a Christian. I'd like you to keep your mind open, though, until you hear the whole critique. Though you might not end up agreeing with me, I hope you will at least understand why conservative Christians, people like me, think the way we do about the time we're in. Second, I imagine that there'll be some of you who agree more or less with the diagnosis of cultural crisis, but not with the proposed solutions. If this is you and you are a Christian, I invite you to help come up with something else we might do, some alternative solution or strategy to the Benedict option, because the problem we're dealing with is not going to go away. I would also appeal to you non-believers in the audience who nevertheless may share our view that the wheels are going to come off or may come off really soon, to start a dialogue with Christians who feel the same way. Because you never know, we might be able to work together on issues of mutual concern and communal support. Well, with that out of the way, let me begin with a story. Nobody saw the great flood coming. I'm not talking about the great flood of the Bible. I'm talking about the great flood of Louisiana last summer, South Louisiana. The newspaper in Baton Rouge said that heavy, heavy rains were headed to South Louisiana on that August weekend. But it was really nothing unusual for us because Louisiana is a pretty wet place, especially in the summertime. The weatherman said we could expect 3 to 6 inches of rain over a 3-day period, which is a lot, but you know, we can handle it. By the time the rain stopped, the deluge had dropped over 30 inches of water on the greater Baton Rouge area. Places that no one ever imagined would see high water disappeared as rivers and creeks burst their banks. People fled their houses and climbed to high ground on their roofs with minutes to spare. Some people didn't even have that much time, and they were lucky to float out holding on to something with their families sometimes where rescuers found them. Serving jambalaya to hungry and dazed evacuees at a shelter that Sunday, I heard the same story over and over from people who had been rescued. We've lost everything. We never expected this. It has never flooded where we live. We were not prepared. Those confused and homeless evacuees could be forgiven for their lack of preparation for a flood like that. Nobody in that part of Louisiana had ever thought about buying flood insurance because, unlike around New Orleans, we're higher up. But why would they have thought to buy flood insurance? This flood in this place was a 1,000-year weather event, and nobody in recorded history had ever seen this land underwater. People literally could not imagine something like this happening. Well, I believe that we Christians in the West, which is to say not the global South or the East, but in the West, we're facing our own 1,000-year flood, or if you believe Pope Benedict XVI, a 1,500-year flood. The Pope said, Pope Emeritus said that the spiritual crisis overtaking the West is the most serious since the fall of the Roman Empire near the end of the 5th century. Now, for a Pope, the leader of a billion Catholics around the world, to say something like that, well, that's pretty huge. Pope Benedict, I believe, was right. Even as the Christian faith spreads in the global South and in China, the light of Christianity is flickering out over the West, over our civilization. This may not be the end of a world, the end of the world, but it is the end of a world. The West has become post-Christian. For a long time, Christians like me have downplayed or ignored the signs. Others of us have confined our thinking about such things to the fever swamps of the popular apocalypticism, the left behinds, or in my generation, the late great planet Earth, which I find, frankly, to be worse than useless when it comes to addressing the actual spiritual crisis that we're in. Well, now the floodwaters, so to speak, are upon us, and we are not ready. The storm clouds have been gathering for decades, but most of us believers have operated under the illusion that they would eventually blow over. For most of my adult life, many Christian conservatives thought that strengthening the laws or the levies of law and politics would keep the flood of secularism at bay and allow us to take back the culture for Christ, to use a phrase popular among many in the old school religious right. Well, today in 2017, we can see that Christian conservatives, or I think a more accurate way to put it would be small O Orthodox Christians, have lost on nearly every front. The swift and relentless currents of secularism have overwhelmed our flimsy barriers. the public square has been lost. Not only have we lost the public square, but the supposed high ground of our own institutions, that's not necessarily a safe place either. Well, they let the world do what it's going to do, we might think. We can still retain our faith and our teaching within the walls of our churches so our kids can be salt and light in the world. Well, that sounds good on paper, but one big problem with it is the internet and smartphone culture. I come from a wonderful small town, a place to which people move to get out of the big city, especially to put their kids in the really good public school. The town is like Mayberry. When my family and I moved back there a few years ago, my wife looked around to see if there were any other homeschooling families around. She asked the first homeschooling mom she found why she and her husband had pulled their kids out of the local public school, given that it's one of the best in the state. That mom, a Southern Baptist, told my wife that it was the day their fifth grade son came home from school and said that his friends were all watching hardcore pornography on their smartphones. I have to make something clear. In no way was this the fault of the school. School would not let kids have phones there. But these kids were nevertheless watching this hardcore porn, fifth graders, with phones that their parents had given them. Well, that mother and father who pulled their kids out of the local school at great cost to themselves, socially and otherwise, they rightly understood that the peer culture into which their children would be assimilated was toxic, overwhelmingly so. And they said, no, we can't do that to our kids. There are many Christians who think that their kids can avoid this stuff by going to Christian school. I think they're deluding themselves. Over and over, I've spoken to teachers and principals at Christian schools who tell me that permissive parenting undermines and even undoes the work of formation that they try to do with students during the school hours. What's more, churches often are no help to Christian parents trying to buck the tide. The church thinks it's co-opting culture, but in fact, using pop culture's technologies and techniques. In that way, the culture is co-opting the church. Reflecting on the defeat within his own Anglican church of the traditional marriage cause, the conservative evangelical theologian Ephraim Radner, who opposes same-sex marriage, said that same-sex marriage is, quote, a late-stage sign of a far deeper, wider, and long-rooted set of cultural and social changes that have completely reoriented human existence away from its prior and universal understanding of purpose. These changes have engulfed almost all Christians in the world, Ephraim Radner said, largely because they are global changes, systemic in every respect, complex and voracious. What has happened, said Radner, is nothing less than a revolution in what it means to be human. In that regard, he says, there is no safe place in the world or in our churches within which to be a Christian. It is a new epoch. No safe place, no higher ground to retreat to. It is indeed a new epoch. I think the Great Flood is a good metaphor to understand what has happened to Western culture over the past 100 years or so. We live in what the sociologist Zygmunt Bauman calls liquid modernity. Liquid modernity is a term coined by Bauman to describe the experience of chaos in our time. To understand what he means, we have to first ask ourselves, what is solid modernity? It's hard to place an exact date on when the modern period started. Some say with the Renaissance, others say with the Reformation, some say with the Scientific Revolution, others say with the Peace of Westphalia, and still others say it didn't really begin until the 18th century Enlightenment. What we can all agree on, though, is that this passage to modernity ushered in a very different way of thinking about ourselves, our societies, and even the reality around us. Generally speaking, modernity is a time in which humankind has deliberately and consciously cut itself off from its roots in the past, in the sense that we began to believe that the authority of the past and these customary institutions had no claim on us. Modernity is marked by the gradual liberation of the autonomous choosing individual from inherited and prescribed forms. No more kings, no more state churches, nothing but the free individual pursuing happiness, and a world increasingly dominated by science, technology, and the free markets. This didn't mean that everything changed overnight, obviously. True, the American and the French revolutions, as well as the Industrial Revolution, began to break up the old way of living in a very consequential way. But modernity at that point was still solid in the sense that the rate of change was not so fast that people felt that the world around them was unstable. At some point, though, the rate of change became so great that, in the words of Karl Marx, everything that is solid melts into air. He was describing capitalism, the revolutionary force of capitalism. If you think of early, sometimes I think about early modernity as like an iceberg. As time has passed, the rate of change has acted as a heat-generating friction on settled institutions and customs, causing them to melt. Now, because of that melting, we live in liquid modernity, a time in which the rate of change is so fast that nothing, no new institutions, no new customs, nothing has a chance of solidifying into anything stable before it changes again. In liquid modernity, says Zygmunt Bauman, man ceases to be a pilgrim and rather becomes a tourist. Well, what does he mean by this? He means that the journey through life is no longer experienced as it long had been in Christian society, as a pilgrimage from one place, one starting place, to a definite destination, the Christian heaven. Every step of the journey in this conception of life was meaningful. If it was possible to fail at the pilgrimage, it was possible to fail at the pilgrimage, but at least we had a destination, a definite direction, and we could measure our progress by maps provided by tradition. And this is a journey, this pilgrimage through life is a journey we undertake with others. All of us in this older view are presumed to be changed by our journey, by contact with the places we visit as pilgrims. Now though, the pilgrim as archetype has been replaced by the tourist. A tourist has no set itinerary. He goes where he wants to go on his own time. He stays until he's bored and then he moves on. The tourist preserves his freedom of movement by avoiding commitments to places, to other people, to ways of life. He always keeps his options open. The highest good to the tourist is the freedom he has to choose wherever he wants to go, to follow his own stars. After all, the only value of the places the tourist visits are those he assigns them. He sucks out of it what he can get out of it and moves on. If that kind of freedom sounds not so bad, well, it just shows how well we've all been catechized by modernity. All of this individual freedom has been wonderful for us in many respects, but it has come at a tremendous cost to social solidarity, in a sense of sharing an idea of the common good and what we have to do to serve the common good, and in confidence that life has ultimate meaning. This is an age of great anxiety among all of us today, in great part because of this. All of us can feel that. Nothing is stable, or very little is stable anymore, it often seems. Side note, I'm asked from time to time about young people who want to go to college to study journalism. And they ask me, should I do that? And I tell them, no, you shouldn't. I've had a good career as a journalist, and I think there's so many journalists doing great work, but nobody can guarantee a stable future in journalism. And they don't like to hear that, but I've seen so many people, good men and women, be fired because of the rapid changes in technology. So that's one, when I was the last generation of journalists who could graduate from journalism school and think that we had a job for life, and that's over now. But when you multiply that across all these different industries, you can see that at least economically, things are going to be ever more disrupted over the next decades. Anyway, this is a problem for all of us. In my book, I talk to two older women I know, have them sitting on a front porch talking to each other. One had said that over the past year, she had been to six baby showers for various family members. None of them had husbands. Most of them had multiple children, were never married. The older woman was shocked by this. It had all fallen apart for her family in a single generation. Those children were being raised in highly unstable family situations under very precarious economic circumstances. That working class woman could not understand how the beliefs, customs and practices under which she and her generation had been raised had collapsed so quickly. This is what it means to live in liquid modernity. None of us escape it. There are fewer and fewer guardrails anywhere in society anymore. The philosopher Alistair MacIntyre said that under these conditions, we have no choice in the West but to continue fragmenting because we have increasingly little to bind us together under all these different stresses. If society is nothing more than the sum total of all its atomized individuals seeking fulfillment of their own desires, then we cannot hold together. Worse, we lack the very thing that all societies have to bind them, a shared idea of sacred order. The late social critic Philip Reeve was an unbeliever, but he was deeply concerned about the fate of Western civilization. He said that no society can exist without a shared concept of sacred order, that is, the belief that there is a way that the world is supposed to be, the way the world is and is supposed to be, and that we all have to conform to that that order outside ourselves in some way. Culture is the thing through which sacred order manifests itself. All cultures, in Philip Reeve's social theory, consist of thou shalt and thou shalt nots. What sets modern culture apart from any other culture that came before it is that we are dedicated to demolishing all of the thou shalt nots. We are therefore, in Reeve's view, an anti-culture, one that destroys the basis for its very own long-term existence. Philip Reeve said that we have developed a therapeutic way of dealing with the loss of shared meaning. That is, we seek to satisfy our own desires and to feel good about ourselves, but this can't last forever. Not certainly in a world of diminished diminished prospects, and a lot of the social dislocation that we're about to start experiencing. Anyway, we find ourselves living out what the author Gil Bailey calls mimetic promiscuity, which is a fancy way of saying that we are in a constant state of making choices guided by nothing more than our desires. The more one does this, the more one's personality disintegrates, and the less weight one's life has. In this way, freedom, in the modern sense, can actually come to mean slavery to our passions. This is true for all of us, but for Christians specifically, liquid modernity poses particular problems. Liquid modernity is the universal solvent dissolving our traditional understanding of what it means to be Christian. We have degenerated into a condition, I'm talking about we Christians, into a condition that sociologist Christian Smith calls moralistic therapeutic deism. It is a false Christianity that uses the language and structures of traditional Christianity, but has hollowed them out. Under MTD, people believe that God exists and he wants us to be happy and nice to other people, but that's about it. God is a cosmic butler who only needs to be consulted when we need something. He's the ultimate permissive daddy. This, says Christian Smith, is the de facto religion of most Americans across the board. If you want to get an idea of how corrosive it is to authentic Christian values, you should see the research Smith and his colleagues at Notre Dame released in 2011 about the spiritual lives of Christians aged 18 to 23. 61% of that group said they have no problem at all with consumerism and materialism as Christians. 30% of that group said, yeah, consumerism and materialism, I can see why that would be a real challenge to Christian life, but we can't do anything about it, so we're not going to worry about it. Only 9% of self-identified Christians saw a serious challenge to Christian living by the sort of shopping and culture we have, and thought they should do something about it. So if only 9% of people recognize, people who identify as members of the church recognize there's a problem here, then that tells us how far down we've gone. Whenever I go speak at Christian colleges and universities, I hear the same thing from professors, that nearly all of their students, kids who had come from Christian backgrounds and chose to go to a Christian college, nearly all of their students know next to nothing about the Christian faith. All they know is that Jesus is their best friend. It's all about emotion for them, the entire experience of faith. To them, holiness is about feeling good about themselves and little more. If this is what Christianity is, this is what it has become, it can't last and it doesn't deserve to last. You can see maybe why Pope Benedict said that the West is in a spiritual crisis worse than any since the fall of Rome. This is why I say that Christians today should turn to Saint Benedict as a guide for how we can respond effectively to this spiritual crisis that is really a crisis of civilization. Well, why Benedict? Who was Saint Benedict and what did he accomplish? One day near the turn of the 6th century, a young Christian Roman named Benedict said goodbye to his hometown, Nursia, a rugged village pocketed away in the mountains of central Italy. He was the son of Nursia's governor, and he was on his way to Rome, where promising young men seeking a place in the world went to complete their education. But this was no longer the Rome of imperial glory. Nearly 70 years before Benedict was born, the Visigoths had sacked the Eternal City. The collapse of the city of Rome in that year, 410, was a staggering blow to the morale of citizens across the once mighty empire. St. Augustine wrote his masterpiece, The City of God, to explain to traumatized Christians what had happened to them. This was the 9/11 of the Roman world. They could not imagine that anybody could touch their city, but it got sacked. Well, Christians throughout the empire mourned because Rome's suffering forced them to confront a terrible fact that the foundations of the world that they and their ancestors had known were crumbling right before their eyes. Well, the city of Rome, of course, did not disappear, but by the time young Benedict arrived there to continue his studies, Rome was a pathetic shadow of its former self. It was lost to decadence and dissolution. The barbarians were ruling the place and everything was falling apart. Benedict was so shocked and disgusted by the vice and corruption in the city that he turned his back on the life of privilege that awaited him there as the son of a government official. He moved to the nearby forest and, as one does, later to a cave. There, Benedict lived as a hermit for 3 years, praying and fasting and asking God to show him what to do. When he came out, Benedict had a reputation locally for sanctity and was invited by a monastic community to be their abbot. Eventually, Benedict would found 13 monasteries of his own in that region south of Rome. To guide the monks and later the nuns in his religious order, that is, to help them live simple, orderly lives consecrated to Christ in a world of chaos and uncertainty, Benedict wrote a very slim and plain little book, now known as the Rule of Saint Benedict. For the early monastics, a rule was simply a guide for living in Christian community. In his rule, Benedict describes a monastery as a school for the Lord's service. In that sense, all the rule is a practical training manual for how to do spiritual training. When he died in the year 547, Benedict could not possibly have imagined the impact that his monastic movement would have over time. In the Dark Ages, the church was often the strongest and perhaps the only government people had. The monastic movement spread like wildfire under these conditions. These monasteries kept faith and learning alive within their walls. They evangelized barbarian peoples and taught them how to pray and how to read, but also how to plant crops and how to build things. The monks worked tirelessly to copy and recopy not only scripture, but the works of the church fathers, as well as classic works from pagan antiquity. Over the next few centuries, they prepared the devastated societies of post-Roman Europe for the rebirth of civilization centuries later. It all grew from the mustard seeds of faith planted by a faithful Christian young layman, Benedict. He never became a priest, who wanted nothing more than to seek and to serve God in a community of faith constructed to withstand the chaos and decadence all around them. The monks bore witness to an alternative way of life, one ordered around serving Christ and community. We all know if we had any history of the Middle Ages, we know about the excesses of the monasteries, many of which, like every human institution, fell into corruption and abused their power. yeah, we shouldn't let the failures of monastics throughout history dissuade us from re-examining the meaning of their movement, what it can mean to us today, and learning what we as lay Christians can use from their example. So why does Benedict's example give us hope today? Because it reveals what a small cohort of convicted believers who respond creatively to the challenges of their own time and place can accomplish by channeling the grace that flows through them from their radical openness to God and embodying that grace in a distinct and distinctly countercultural way of life. I think of the Benedictine monasteries of the early Middle Ages like as if they were a flotilla of arcs that preserved the Christian faith and the legacy of Greco-Roman culture during a time of prolonged crisis. Christians today who feel besieged by these raging floodwaters of modernity await someone like Benedict to help build arcs capable of carrying them and their faith across this sea of our current crisis, a dark age that, for all we know, could last centuries. So the question of the Benedict option is, do conservative Christians today remain committed to the system, living as if we were more or less in normal times? Or do we construct new forms of community and radically strengthen the ones we have now to provide the resilience that will allow the Christian faith to live on for generations and generations to come through what will be an incredible time of trial, not only for the church, but for all society? That choice, again, I call the Benedict option. The Benedict option is a general strategy for lay Christians that draws on the authority of Scripture and the wisdom of the ancient church to embrace exile in place and form a thick Christian counterculture. Recognizing the toxins of modern secularism, as well as the fragmentation caused by relativism, Benedict option Christians look to Scripture, tradition, and the inspiration of Benedict's rule, seeking ways to cultivate practices in community, true Christian practices in communities. Rather than remaining panicky or complacent in this crisis, they recognize that a new post-Christian order is not a problem to be solved, not a problem that can be solved, but rather it's a reality to be lived with for the foreseeable future. It calls on believers to learn how to navigate these treacherous waters and endure with faith and creativity, to deepen their own prayer lives, adopting practices and building institutions within which the traditional Christian faith can survive and prosper through this flood. This is not just about our own survival as Christians. Here's a paradox. If we are going to be for the world as Christ meant us to be, we're going to have to spend more time away from the world in deep prayer, in stillness, in contemplation, and substantial spiritual training, just as Jesus retreated to the desert to pray before beginning his ministry to the people. We cannot give the world as Christians what we do not have. If the ancient Hebrews in their Babylonian exile had been assimilated by the culture of Babylon, Israel would have ceased to be a light unto the world. I think it's that way with the church too, today. Today, the town of Nursia is called Norcia, and it's home to a living community of Benedictine monks, most of them Americans. I write about them in the Benedict option. In fact, chapter 3 is all about them, and they are the heart. Whatever else you hear said about the book, those monks and the spiritual life they lead, that's the heart of the book. These men are amazing. They are... I really believed, I've been there twice to meet them and be with them, and they are true lights into the world, and I hope I've paid them proper tribute in the book. The basic thing that sets Benedictine monks, all Benedictine monks, apart from the rest of us, is that they lead an entirely integrated life centered around the worship of God. True monks do spend a lot more time in formal worship of God than the rest of us do, but that's not really the key to understanding them. The key is that they consider every single thing they do to be an act of worship. That is, they believe there is a such thing as a sacred order, an order of reality that exists beyond us and includes us, and that God has revealed the sacred order to us. We are called to order our own lives around sacred reality, and in so doing, make clear the way for the grace of God to transform us and to make us more like Christ. That's how they see it. Well, what does that mean concretely? It means that the rule of Saint Benedict prescribes a highly structured way of life for the monks, a regimen of prayer, work, fasting, and study that works in an integrated way to draw monks closer to Jesus and closer to each other. I sat down last year in Norcia with Father Cassian Folsom, the American monk who refounded the Norcia Monastery, to ask him to explain their life for me. He started by saying that the monastery and the life of prayer within it exists as a sign of contradiction to the modern world. The guardrails have disappeared and the world risks going off a cliff, he told me. But all of us in the world, he was speaking to me, are so captured by the lights and the motions of modern life that we don't recognize the danger. The forces of dissolution from popular culture are too great for individuals or families to resist on their own. For this reason, Father Cassian explained, all Christians need to embed ourselves in stable communities of faith. Well, right there, that is a challenge to a lot of American lay Christians because we like to jump around from church to church. I'm a good example of that, but nevertheless, this is our condition. Benedict's rule is a detailed set of instructions for how to organize and govern a monastic community in which monks live together in poverty and chastity. That is common to all monastic living, but Benedict's rule adds three distinct vows: obedience, stability, which is fidelity to that same monastery where you make your profession until you die, and conversion of life, which means to dedicate oneself to a lifelong work of deepening repentance. Far from being a way of life for only the strong and the disciplined, as you might think from the outside, Benedict's rule was and is for the ordinary and the weak to help them grow stronger in faith. Despite the very specific instructions found in the rule, it's really not a checklist for legalism. Father Cassian told me, the purpose of the rule is to free you. That's a paradox people don't readily grasp. A rule works that way, to channel your spiritual energy, your work, your activity, and so on, so that you're able to accomplish something. Monastic life, he told me, is very plain. People from the outside perhaps have a romantic vision, perhaps what they see on television of monks sort of floating around the cloister. There is that, and that's attractive, but basically, he said, monks get up in the morning, they pray, they do their work. They pray some more, they eat, they pray, they do some more work. They pray some more, and then they go to bed. It's rather plain, just like most people. The genius of Saint Benedict is to find the presence of God in everyday life, close quote. People who are anxious, confused, and looking for answers are quick to search for solutions in the pages of books or on the internet, looking for that killer app or that secret piece of information that will make everything right again. The rule of Saint Benedict says, no, it's not like that. You can achieve the peace and order you seek only by making a place within your heart and within your daily life for the grace of God to take root. Divine grace is freely given, but God will not force us to receive it. It takes constant effort on our part to get out of God's way and let His grace heal and change us. This is the way Benedictines think. To this end, what we think does not matter as much as what we do and how faithfully we do it. This is the philosophy of the Benedictines. There are lots of little things they do to make that sacred order that they see incarnate in everyday life. And I talked to them about that in the book. But the important thing to realize now or tonight is that there is nothing woo-woo, mystical, spiritual about the Benedictine life. It is a spirituality for everyday people. It's a spiritual path that trains all of us to make the whole world holy by the little things we do, day in and day out, recognizing the reality that God is all around us. Benedictine spirituality is not so much about what we believe, though Orthodox Christian belief is presumed, but it's really about how we put those beliefs into practice. It is a spirituality of discipleship. St. Benedict called his monasteries schools from the service of the Lord. We who live outside of the monasteries, we Christians, have to build out every part of our life to be like schools for the service of the Lord. The rest of life in this post-Christian world is a school for the service of the self. It is precisely in this way that lay Christians have to be countercultural as Christians. That's the general thrust of the Benedict option. There are, of course, lots of objections, some of them quite good, to the Benedict option. But the one I hear most of all is, oh, you just want us all to head for the hills and build separatist compounds. Not true at all. I tend to hear that kind of thing from two kinds of people, though. The first are ex-fundamentalists, or people maybe one generation away from fundamentalism, who, when they hear this kind of talk about separation and living a different life and putting barriers between us and the world, and they hear that and not the fundamentalism fear or a fundamentalist fear of the world. Well, I had to admit that I've never known fundamentalist in my own life, despite growing up in the very deep South. In my part of Louisiana, mostly Protestant, but they were more like mainline Protestants, and we just didn't have fundamentalists. So I didn't quite know what they were dealing with. As I listened to people, though, I came to understand, so this is why this freaks you out. I get it. But my own experience growing up was just of a very loosey-goosey cultural Christianity, and I wanted something with more rigor and more depth. But some of the ex-fundamentalists I talked to said, yeah, but you gotta be really careful, and here's why. This was all very useful for me. But we have to admit, though, that no community can be 100, or any kind, can be 100% free of the prospect for the abuse of power, the manipulation of the kind of fear that a lot of fundamentalists I talked to said they had, and that alienated them from the faith. But we can't let that reality stop us from trying new things. It's true that over the long history of monasticism, many of the monasteries fell into luxury, into the power of worldliness, and into corruption and abuse of power. There's no human institution free of this possibility. We have to be vigilant about this among ourselves. But it's also true that the Benedict option has to be seen less as a running away from something bad, as a running towards something good. I talked to the headmaster of a classical Christian school in doing my research for the book. He told me that 90% of the families coming into this classical Christian school, having their kids there, are there to escape what they perceive are the problems of the public school. But this headmaster is trying to get them understand that they're actually should be running towards something good. These are objective goods here, not just a place to hide, but a place to flourish outside of this order that you find problematic. But the headmaster did say you have to work with people where they are. But we have to keep straight in our minds that it's important to get away from bad things, but we who are not most deeply committed to opening up ourselves to the good, the true, and the beautiful essence of Christian life, well, we're doing it wrong. Another complaint I get is that the Benedict option sees the rest of the world as unimportant and doesn't care if it goes to hell or not as long as we save ourselves. That's not true either. To be fair, the Benedict option does call on Christians to prioritize the upbuilding of local Christian communities. This is what it means to do as the philosopher Alistair MacIntyre said regarding the need, back in the day when Rome fell, there were people who turned away from assuming that the idea of moral community, you have to shore up the Roman Empire or what's left. And instead, they formed communities of their own within which the moral life can be lived out in a difficult time. Alistair MacIntyre said that St. Benedict is the epitome of that. But anyway, I think to prioritize the local church and the local community, different institutions of the church, that's what it means to quit trying to shore up the empire and to build local communities. If we can't effectively resist in community the disintegrating effect of post-Christian culture, even within our own congregations, of what use are we to the world? It's true that Christians are called to be salt and light to the world. Near total withdrawal from the world, like the monks do, is neither possible nor desirable for most of us. But here's a crucial distinction. We Christians cannot be salt and light from the world if we don't start spending a lot more time away from the world, forming our consciences. One of the monks in Norcia explained it to me like this. The rule of Saint Benedict commands monks to offer hospitality to anyone who shows up. And this the monks do. They treat them as if they were Christ himself, according to what Saint Benedict demands. They have an open door, but that open door policy is not without conditions. They want to share, these monks, with pilgrims the fruits of their lives as monks, what God has done for them and through them as monks. But if they're going to have anything to share with pilgrims as monks, they have to spend a lot of time behind monastery walls, in prayer and in study. If they kept the doors wide open, letting people come and go as they please, all hours of the night, they would never have time for the very practices that train them spiritually so that they can bring Christ to the world as monks. That is their narrow vocation. That same principle is true for us Christians who live in the world. We can't give the world what we don't have. If we don't live lives of Christian witness, what good are Christians in the world in the first place? Think of the Hebrews in their Babylonian exile. Speaking through the prophet Jeremiah, the Lord God told them to accept their exile for a time, that his hand was in that for his own purposes, but to integrate themselves within the life of Babylon. And you know, pray for the peace of the city, I believe in the prosperity of the city. But God also expected of them that they would hold on to their faith and not be seduced by the false gods of Babylon. We see this principle illustrated in the book of Daniel in the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know, as you know, they were three Hebrew men who worked for King Nebuchadnezzar. They saw no conflict between serving the wider good and the king by working for the state. They saw no conflict between that and being faithful servants of the Lord. But when the king built a golden idol and demanded that all of his officials bow before it, those three men knew they couldn't do that and be faithful. Even if it means our deaths, they told the king, we will not bow down before an idol. As you'll remember from the story, the king threw them into a furnace, but the fire didn't consume them. Here's the Benedict option point to that story. The Hebrews living in Babylon were in that world, but not of it. So when the time came between choosing, between apostatizing, leaving the true faith to pray to the idols, to go along, to get along, or to choose suffering, even unto death, they chose to serve the true God no matter what. The Benedict option has to be about training we Christians who are in the world how to stay faithful in a faithless world and how to be resilient like that if we are asked to disobey God or to serve the state or any other order. We will have to have within ourselves what it takes to make that ultimate sacrifice. We cannot die for the sake of Christ if we are ever put to that rare and terrible test if we have not been dying for the sake of Christ every day in small ways. In a more prosaic way, if we have not been forming our hearts, minds, and souls in Christ by the practices of everyday life, we are going to lose our way and eventually lose our faith. We will not become Christian pilgrims, but rather Christian tourists. In his rule, Saint Benedict describes monks who live this way, flitting around from place to place, taking what they can before moving on. He calls them the worst kind of monks there are. This problem has been with the church for a long time, this spiritual tourism. Well, the good news is that despite this dire prediction, and when I talk about martyrdom, I don't believe that this is around the corner at all. I'm just saying we have to plan out, we have to ask ourselves, what would we be willing to suffer for the sake of our faith? It's going to happen in so many ways. I think none of us here, praise God, will have to face that, even though many Christians around the world do. But it's a good way to start to think about that, about who is our real God. Anyway, the good news is that there are plenty of Christians, Protestant, Catholic, and Eastern Orthodox, around the West today, doing creative work to ensure that the faith survives this new dark age. Let me emphasize again, the Benedict option is not a strategy for achieving political power or a self-help manifesto or a church growth exercise. It is about nothing greater than helping Christians unite ourselves more radically to Christ in a post-Christian time. So we can relate to the wider community, we can be faithful to them and give to them out of the goodness of our bounty. St. Benedict did not set out for the forest determined to make Rome great again. All he wanted to do was to figure out how to serve God faithfully in community and every other good thing that happened for the wider community, even the non-Christians, came from that choice he made. In my travels in search of the Benedict option, I found no more complete embodiment of it than the Tipilowski, a vigorously orthodox, joyfully countercultural Catholic community in Italy that Father Cassian of Norcia recommended to me. To give you an idea of their spirit, Tipilowski, the name of their group, means the usual suspects. About 150 families in the Tipilowski. Driving with their leader, Marco Sermarini, through the hills above his city on the Adriatic last year, having spent a day with them and seeing their school and all the great things they have there that they've all built for themselves, I asked him how the rest of us could have that joy that his community has discovered. Because every one of them is a very Orthodox Catholic, meaning that they follow the church's teaching strictly, but they're not mad about it. They love being Catholic and faithful, and they're not angry and bitter. It's a deeply attractive thing. Marco said that we have to start getting serious about living as Christians. He said that we have to accept that there can be no middle ground. The Tipilowski began as a group of young Catholic men who wanted more out of life than moralistic therapeutic deism. That used to be my life, said Marco. I did not know the teaching of Jesus Christ was for all my life, not just the religious part of it. If you recognize that he is the Lord of all, you will order your life in a radically different way. Again, this is this late Christian's advice to other Christians in the West. What Marco and his friends found, to their great surprise, was that everything they needed to live faithfully together had been right in front of them all along. We invented nothing, he said. We discovered nothing. We are only rediscovering a tradition that was locked away inside an old box. We had forgotten. Marco pulled his SUV over on the side of a narrow country road. We got out, and he led me to a steep hillside. It was covered with olive trees. This was the Sermarini family olive grove. As a boy, Marco's 91-year-old father helped the guy I'd met the night before, had helped his own father harvest olives from these trees. Marco was raised doing the same, and now he and his own children collect olives yearly and press it all for their family's use. You know, as an American, to look at that and to see it is just to marvel. I said, that's stability, Marco. So he shrugged and he looked out over his trees. He said, I don't know what's going to happen next in life, but in the meantime, we have to fight for the good. The possibility of saving the good things in the world is only that, a possibility. We have to take the chances we have to set a rock in the earth and to keep this rock steady. So we walk back to his SUV, we climb in, and Marco says to me, nothing we make in this life will be eternal, but we have to build them as if they will be eternal. That's what God wants. If you promise yourself to a woman for a lifetime, that's a way of making the eternal present here in time. We will only can make the eternal present through our own fidelity. We have to go forward in confidence that the little things we do in community, in Christian community, might in time grow into mighty works, Marco said. It's all up to God. All we can do is our very best to serve him. Marco told me that sometimes he lies in bed at night worrying that his efforts with his community and the efforts of his little Christian brothers and sisters that have gathered together there won't amount to much in the face of so much opposition in the world beyond. He's anxious that the current of dissolution from liquid modernity will be too strong to resist, for his own community members to resist, and will tear them apart. He said to me, I know from the olive trees that some years we will have a big harvest and others years we will take few. The monks, when they brought agriculture to this place 1,000 years ago, they taught our ancestors that there are times when we have to save seed. That's why I think we have to walk on this road of St. Benedict and your Benedict option, Marco said to me. this is a season for saving the seed. If we don't save the seed now, we won't have a harvest in the years to come. The Tipiloski have a close relationship with the monks of Norcia. They look up to Father Cassian as their own spiritual father. He's a very wise man. On my very first trip to Norcia, a year or two before I started working on this Benedict Option book, I told Father Cassian about this idea. I was really nervous about meeting him, especially given his reputation as a deeply spiritual man. Plus, it seemed really presumptuous for me, no longer a Catholic, an ex-Catholic, to go sit down with the abbot of the monastery in St. Benedict's hometown and say, so I've got this Benedict Option idea. And I was just afraid of what he would say. I thought he might think I'm foolish or might think I'm just some apocalyptic weirdo. I'm not apocalyptic. The rest of it, I can't. Anyway, Father Cassian listened to me over lunch, and he told me that the idea was not foolish at all. He told me that the West is in much worse spiritual shape than most Christians, Catholics and Protestants, even realize. He said that most Christians don't see any big problems now or coming down the pike, but they are very, very wrong. The old monk told me that people who want to stay Christian and to keep their children and grandchildren Christian are going to be those who do some form of what you call the Benedict Option, he said to me. They're going to have to radically change their lives and their ways of living and of living in community. The days of cultural Christianity are over. The flood is here. We've got to build these arcs. Well, what about those who don't? I asked Father Cassian. He looked me straight in the eyes and said, they're not going to make it. Well, I've written the Benedict Option for Christians who are determined to make it. Thank you very much.
We have about 15 minutes for some questions. I'm sure many of you have questions. And by the way, after the question answer session, after we we're going to convene in outside. There's food and drink for reception. So if you have further questions, we can mingle at that point. So any questions?
Thank you so much. I'm just really curious. How old are your kids, and how do you live this out right now with your family, where you live?
My kids are 17, 13, and 10. And one way we're living it out is at the end of, or last summer, in the middle of the summer, we lost the pastor at our little mission church out in the country. And it didn't look like they were gonna be able to replace the priest, which as Eastern Orthodox Christians means the next parish nearby, but 45 minutes away. My wife and I were at the point in our lives when we realized we had to have a church community, be close to the church in order to keep our own family spiritually anchored. Plus, our kids started going to a classical Christian school in Baton Rouge, and that was going to require a lot of commuting, 90 minutes round trip each day. So we decided to leave our house we loved and our neighbors we loved to move into the city for the sake of church and school, Christian school community. That's one sacrifice we made, but we felt like it was important for our family. And another way we do in our house, we're extremely strict about smartphones for the kids. Our 17-year-old has one because he's driving, and but the other ones, they don't have them. And my 13-year-old and my 10-year-old, we also limit the TV that comes into the house. We have our TV only hooked up to Netflix and Amazon streaming. So that helps us curate what they get to see and control what they get to see. These are small things, but I mean, it's shocking to me how many conservative Christian parents, give their kids these smartphones. That story I told in the talk, that is becoming more and more prevalent. But by putting these walls up between my family and the world, as small as they are, they're important. And the thing is, what my wife and I are convicted about is we're not just about protecting them from bad things. We are helping them deal with actual moral problems in the world and actual things that happen in the real world. or we're letting them do it, or we're guiding them, informing them behind with some protection from the nastier things in the world. So I don't think that our kids are being brainwashed or anything like that, as some people like to say, like, oh, you're keeping them away from joining the mainstream culture. It is true that we're keeping them away from joining the mainstream culture, but I don't apologize for that. I think it's the right thing to do. There's all ways to improve that sort of thing, and I'm eager to hear from other parents who have figured out how to do this.
My question involves place. My understanding is that you're not necessarily encouraging Christians to head for specific areas. So you raised that Italian community. That's not necessarily what you're advocating for. But what if you're located in a city, a region, where there's less of a Christian presence? I'm sorry, I haven't read your book, but do you speak about that in your book, this question of physical location?
I do. I cited in the book the modern Orthodox Jews as a great example to Christians about what we ought to strive for. Jews have always been on the margins, or long on the margins of Western society because of anti-Semitism, but they've had to learn how to live out their faith, the modern Orthodox, in a world that really rejects some of the things their practices. And one of the things they do is they have to live near their synagogue because they can't drive on the Sabbath. And so that right there, that limitation within their religious practice helps form community. And so that's one way to do it, but that's not going to be feasible for most of us. I mean, as an Eastern Orthodox Christian, you can imagine we're pretty thin on the ground in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. But so we have to make modifications too. I mean, the Benedict option does not lay down a formula because it talks about having to take a look around in your local culture, see what the realities are, what's needed, what's possible, and don't let any sort of ideal of perfection get in the way of doing something good enough for right now. The challenges of being a Christian in a largely non-Christian or hostile culture are very different from being and different temptations that people who live in a primarily Christian culture, one that's at least formed by Christian ideas, have different kinds of temptations, I think.
I feel some of the pressures that you feel, not to the extent that you do, but I find an awful lot of solace, particularly as I get older, in a narrowing community of friends and people, my ideals, my values, people to whom I could trust and turn to. They're an eclectic group, though.
Right.
They're Jews, they're non-believers, they're serious Christians, they're waffling Christians. But we have other things in common that I think you would admire. So what's different about the community that you talk about in my community that I find so much sustenance from?
Yeah, well, I think that the first and obviously that it's the confessing the belief in Jesus Christ. That's the church. But it doesn't mean that we can't be part of wider communities, including people who maybe don't go to our church, who aren't even Christian, but people like you're talking about. I think it's a false distinction to say that we have to only stay, if we do the Benedict option, only stay within very narrow church circles for all our friends. I don't live that way. I don't see the need to live that way. But I have also found that it is, from having lived in New York City and Philadelphia, places where it was a lot more challenging to be Christian than it was in the Deep South or Dallas where I've lived. I found that it really, really helps to have like-minded people around you, not for the sake of forming a bubble that allows you to ignore everybody else, but to help you all face outward together and figure out how to navigate life in this pluralistic world.
Does your book make that point?
I don't know. No, seriously, I don't know that I've spoke about it in that depth, but I surely must have. I think I said in the book, I certainly say here now that I do not believe in, like, oh, we mustn't go out into the world and befriend other people or people unlike us. I would lose three quarters of my friends if I I might lose some enemies too, though.
First, I want to say thanks for writing this book, starting the conversation. I think this is really important. Secondly, I did come out of your book with a bit of the impression that there is a retreat element here, pretty strongly even for me. I was surprised that I came out of it, and so to hear you deny that pretty strongly, I believe you, but I'm trying to kind of reckon, trying to reckon all of this together. And the one place in your book that really jumped out at to me as a retreat piece was the chapter where you talked about political engagement. Especially, you made a very strong point that we need to stay engaged politically on religious liberty issues. But I got the impression that on the rest of it, we kind of need to pull back and focus on building our own communities and not spend so much energy on political engagement. Am I misunderstanding you, or how would you characterize political engagement under the Benedict option as not being a retreat?
Yeah, thank you for that question. And it's a tricky distinction. I mean, I believe as someone who has been a political conservative all of my adult life and who very much felt political engagement was required of me as a faithful Christian, you know, I've come to see that we have, as Christians standing in the public square, have less and less voice and less room to be heard. And it's just going to be a very difficult thing going forward. That does not give us the right to quit fighting for the things we most believe in or for the common good. But it is to be, I think, we have to have a necessary reorientation again towards the local, precisely because we've got too dazzled by access to Republican power. And now it should be pretty clear, and I say this as a conservative, what the Republican Party thinks of social conservatives and Christians. So it's not that I don't vote anymore, I certainly do, but I think that it would make a mistake when we construe political life as only what happens in legislatures or in the campaign trail. Political life broadly conceived, the affairs of the common good of the people around you. And I think that, as I've said, and for reasons I've said, we need to focus on building up stronger Christian communities locally for the sake of faith and for the sake of supporting each other, but also for the sake of being good neighbors. I talk in the book about, again, an extreme case, but one that we can learn from. I talk about I'm sorry, it's lost my memory. But I think that we can, I'm sorry, y'all. I have to admit, it's this altitude sickness thing. I apologize. What's that?
Havel.
Yeah, Václav Havel. Thank you so much. Thank you. Václav Havel. I talk about how these, Václav Benda, who is the only Christian among Havel's circle, how they responded to their political disempowerment by resisting on the local level. Václav Benda, the Catholic dissident, he was a mathematician, but he said he could not be a faithful Christian and withdraw from the public square, which is what the communist government wanted Catholics to do. And so he went out and he said, any time that we bring people together for any good reason, that's politics. That's the kind of politics we can practice, and it builds up what he called the parallel polis, a community that goes alongside another. And I think that that is a form of doing politics too. That it's not an either or. We do have to stay engaged in the normal political process. But I know so many conservatives who think that they've done all they need to do about politics when they vote or forward something on Facebook that they got off of Fox. And you know, I just think that it's got to be, we've got to do something different. Thanks for reminding me about that problem.
This gentleman, and then I'll look at you.
Hi, thanks for being here tonight. You've quoted several philosophers in Roman history where you talked about Benedict returning to the city, found the barbarians living within the walls. Do you believe today that it's important to preserve American culture as it is to preserve Christian ideals? Do you see those two as linked? Can those two things live separately in your opinion?
Oh, that's what a great question. I think this is a tremendous tension that the church is going to face, because for so long, the idea that there was any tension between being a good American and a good Christian, that there was any tension there would have been absurd. But now we're seeing as the culture moves away from Christianity and secularism begins to push Christians or faithful Christians to the margins, I think a lot of Christians are going to have to, will find themselves perhaps challenged by the idea of the not only the political order, but just the social order as they start being treated as bigots simply for believing the tenets of their faith. And I think that they're going to have to decide, is it more important to be a good American or to be a good Christian? And I think as a Christian, there's really no other choice. You have to put God before the state. Or as St. Thomas More said in The Man of All Seasons, he'll die the king's good servant, but God's first. So I'm not as interested in preserving American culture as it is becoming as I am in preserving Christian culture. But that's not to say that I want to see America fail. It's my country too, you know, and we're all in this together. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, thank you very much for your talk. What strikes me about the Benedict Doctrine is it focuses on modernity as a new thing, new pressures on Christianity. I'm interested in seeing America as a resurgence of old pressures on various forms of Christianity. I mean, Anglosphere Christianity in particular involved marginalization of Catholicism and various other branches of Christianity that weren't compatible with either the British or the English way of life, or the American way of life. Many of the same disputes over schooling, over marriage, are just revisiting the 19th century in some ways. In what respects how would you advise someone to look at 19th century preservation of certain forms of oppressed Christianity in light of the Benedict option?
I'm not quite sure I understand how to answer the question. I mean, can you give me an example of 19th century?
Okay, well, look, you have a bunch of immigrant groups who are under extreme pressure to preserve their religion in an environment that want to distort it and atomize it and absorb it. That's now in the 21st century, you see basically small patches of Christianity in a larger way of life. Similarities and differences, maybe. Maybe that's a better way to look at it.
Maybe I can. In the 19th century, there was a large groups of German, Irish, and Italian Catholic immigrants. And of course, there was a second wave at the beginning of the 20th century. But during that time, there was something called the Blaine Amendment, which actually never became part of the Constitution, would have forbade the use of any local or federal tax dollars to be used for any religious purposes. And the attempt was because in those days the public schools were not as they are today, but common schools, that there was thinking that, you know, groups of Catholics would live in their own community and then use the resources. I don't know if that's what you're says, but there's a bunch of, but
well, the Klan tried to suppress Catholic education entirely in some places.
Yeah, so I mean that's the example. I'm teaching law and religion this semester, so it's sort of on the brain. Yeah. But that's the sort of things that, in fact, the Supreme Court in several opinions in the early 20th century ruled in favor of those groups and allowed for them to flourish.
You know, this is why I think it's so important to maintain the sphere of religious liberty, or as one way to put it, we need to preserve our right to be wrong. That's what I tell my friends who are more on the left and really hear religious liberty as a code word for trying to justify bigotry. We'll never agree on the substance, the philosophical substance there, but I hope that we can agree that we live in a liberal enough society where this sphere of protection for religious institutions can be there. So that's why I feel that if we lose religious liberty in the courts and politically, religious liberty as we know it today, it's going to be much more difficult for local Christian communities, Catholic or otherwise, to form resistance. Maybe that's the point.
Yeah, I mean, one advantage the 19th century had is that it wasn't the massive regulatory state of the federal government. You had local control, which allowed it.
Right.
Oh, we have to, time for one more question. I will. Deference to clergy.
I like this sacred order, this hierarchical order that you.
How'd you know I was clergy? I just.
That's a
How do you preach this stuff?
Thank you for coming, everyone. Well, you know, that's a very difficult question, and probably explains why we so rarely hear any sermons. I'm sure this is not true at your church, but over the course of my lifetime, hopping around from lots of church to church, we rarely hear any of this, any of the sacred idols that we have, especially if you're white, middle-class, suburban Christian. The sort of prejudices we have, or the things that we value, rarely get challenged. But I think generally the real witness that will be more powerful for most Christians was to preach with our lives. And I'm really moved by something Pope Benedict XVI said about how the best arguments the church has for itself is the art it produces and the saints it produces. In other words, beauty and goodness lead people ultimately to truth. And Benedict thought this was really important in this period of time, because we're not only post-Christian, we're post-reason, in the sense that people have a common basis from which we can make rational arguments and people accept those arguments. Alistair MacIntyre called the condition in which we live today emotivism, where people feel something, if they feel something is true, then it must be true. So, I think that if we can assimilate into our lives this sacred order, these values, these truths that the church provides to us, and organize our own lives around it, and if we do so in a life-giving way, I believe that the light will come from us and we will have a lot to give to the world. But we first got to get our own house in order. Robert Louis Wilkin, the great church historian, wrote in 2004 in First Things, he said, there is nothing more important for the Christians in the West right now than to tell ourselves our story, because we're forgetting it. And he's talking about that culture is the thing that has transmitted faith down to us. And we are losing even the ability to think in Christian terms. We're losing the vocabulary of the Christian church. And Wilkins said that we have to go back and try to reclaim that. And I think that by doing so in our local areas, and also having a more winsome face to the outside, but not yielding one bit on what we know to be true, I think that's the witness of the lives we have in community and in our families will preach louder than words. That doesn't help you out, Father, because you have to write sermons. But I think that we just all need to be thinking as believers about more ways to witness than simply with words, because it's been my experience as a journalist, even on an editorial board, that when people don't share a common sense of authority, it's so difficult to negotiate the things that would have been pretty easy in the past. So this is something afflicting our whole society. Unfortunately, people only want to hear words to reaffirm what they already believe, but goodness and holiness and beauty can pierce that. I've known that to be true in my life, and I bet a lot of people in this room can say it's true. Thank you for coming out tonight and for listening. And I hope that if you didn't get a chance to talk, that you'll send me your ideas and your suggestions to me at the American Conservative through my blog, because some of the best blog posts I get come from readers who are living out these ideas and seeing some of the same things or seeing different things in their own locality, and who want to share it with others. So thank you.
Join me in thanking Rod Dreher. Thank you, Rod.